Verse 4, and the light was the light of men, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness overcame it not. We're talking about a progression beginning with, in the beginning was the Word. Now, it doesn't say in the beginning was light. It doesn't say in the beginning was life. So, but we realize that the Word is the total thought concept of God. But then we have life and then life. We begin to see this progression. Alright, so this moves us into verse 6, where it continues. It is a continuation of what the Lord is trying to communicate. But up to this point, it has simply declared mostly the truth just as it is, without any particular people or whatever. Okay? And the truth stands totally by itself without us. It is independent of us, though we are not independent of the truth. That's not really the thing. So now we are in verse 6, begin to be introduced to somebody who has come to declare. Okay. And it says, there was a man sent from God. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. And I've often said that you cannot really and truly declare the light. You can as best as you can, but you cannot truly declare that life. In fact, if it's truly a life, then the only way you can really declare it is by living. Would that make sense? You can't even, how can you clearly or fully declare the Word? You can declare words. But the Word is the total thought and concept of God. You're not going to be able to communicate that. You don't even know that. I don't know that. We're not aware of that fully. But we are aware of light that is life to men. That is life to men. We're aware of light that is life to men that emanates, if you will, from this total thought and concept of God. In him was life. And the life is the life of man. When you begin to see this truth the way I'm sharing it right now, not in any other way, not in, I got saved. And when I met Jesus the Savior, he's the light that this is talking about. This isn't talking about. This isn't talking about Jesus the Savior. This was before there was a human ever made, before there was a creation, before there was a need for a Savior. This was reality. Now, God doesn't need light, per se, to know this truth, because this truth is His Son, His one witness. But men need this truth. Okay. So, for somebody, because it says, let's put another link here, the Word in Him is life, the light is the light of men. There was a man, sent from God, named John. Okay, so for a man to enter into this, he must come to the light. Because he is totally unaware of the light. And he does not comprehend the Word as the Father comprehends the Word. And I'm just going to say this. The Logos, the complete thought, there is no other way to comprehend this except by the Father to give one. There is no other way. You do not just come to your, you know, it doesn't matter what men teach, it doesn't matter what anybody says, until you see the heart of the Father in relationship to the Logos, you don't have life. Now, you may know some things. You may be saved, but you don't have the life that we're talking about here, because this is the light of life. You say, but I have life. Yes, you have life, but you have not received the light of the life that you have. The whole Christian world is a testimony to this fact, that many have received life, but they have no clue what life they've got. They have not received light yet about the life that they have, and so everybody does that which is right in their own eyes. Everybody lives according to, and this is where you get denominations. I mean, if everybody was had begun to be brought into the light as the Father has declared him to be. Now, that's light. And that's why John, to declare to men, to put a man here to declare to men, that's why John had to be a man sent from God. He had to be sent from God. He had to be. Because if he wasn't, all he could declare is what everybody else had declared. That there is a God. And even with that, it generates from there. So only as we begin to approach... I'm starting to get tired of using the old words. Truth, reality... I'm not talking. That means something. But I don't want you to get involved in terminology. The way that I was taught by the Holy Spirit, we begin to approach the heart of the Father. He is this nebulous. Must be huge, or created everything, this unknown being. How, by searching, can we know him and know his heart? The answer is that there is nothing that you can do. Now, you can search, but not by your searching will you know. But by a heart that is hungry. Because there are Pharisees that will search, and they cannot find him. But a hungry heart, not through searching, and a hungry heart will admit, if they begin to see the light, that it was never by searching. Because it is this, it's like this veil, it's like this total separation where you cannot see and know him, but you know of him. You know he exists. But he's not like a real person. I don't know how else to put that. He's like a real person that's kind of a boss or something. Something out there, yeah.
So, in other words, back in the beginning, the word, life, and when man came into the picture, it sort of goes backwards, like the life is there, he has the mind, but he has to come to the knowledge of the light, which is mind, the words, which is the total thought concept of the Father, that's what I'm saying, is that in the beginning was nothing, man wasn't even in the picture, it's just the Father. And the Son, which is His Word, light. And then when man came into the picture, man has to go from the light to life. This is a learning process. Learning about the light, learning about the light.
Kind of progressive learning.
Yes.
Okay, that is what I'm trying to primarily bring out here. And so, of the three, Word, life, and light, we are most familiar with life, actually. in terminology and what everybody talks about. And we've experienced it. Those who are born again have experienced the lie. I mean, you cannot, you know, I don't care what you say, you can't get around the fact that you've experienced it, whether you know anything about it or not. And you know in your knower that this is it. Okay. The problem isn't with the lie. The problem is primarily with light and the word. Light has to have a new definition for us. That definition is simply this, the Father's viewpoint. Now that's called light. When you get that viewpoint from the Father, let's put it that way, let's expand that a little bit. The Father's viewpoint, and when you get that viewpoint from the Father, that is the true light. Now why? Why? Because the Father is not going to declare anything but His Son, the Word. He has one thought and one concept. All right. So, we don't know what that is. We don't even understand that relationship, and especially the Father's relationship toward this one called the Word. The only way to even kind of comprehend that is to define the Word as the complete thought and concept of God. That's the only way to even kind of then begin to go, oh, okay, so this is kind of His approach. This is His style. This is His approach. This is what, yes, it is. It is. He's locked in. He is locked in to His Son. That's what was and is to come. And He's not fooled by little objects, little temporary plastics and metals and things. He's not, you know, or clay that has been formed. So he's not all caught up in that. You know, Jesus walked the earth, and they're all running after Him, trying to make Him king. And it says Jesus did not commit Himself to them, for He knew what was in all men. I mean, you know, they're not fooled. They were here long before we were. You know, we're the ones that are of the earth. But Jesus said, you must be born again. You must be born from above. And we have not, we have been saved, but in a sense we haven't been born again. Now we have been born, but I'm just saying that we have not been born from above. How about that? If I'm just some word like that. And you'll find out John, when he starts talking, goes, I'm not him, and this one was before me, and he's from above, and you know, I mean, he saw the designations are right because he's a man sent from God. But he got his life. He claimed to declare the light. He got what he got. What little that was. Right here. Okay. And that's the pattern. That's the pattern. Okay. So, the definitions of light is all important. Because anything, and this is a discipline thing. Anything that is not true light, I don't want to call light. I don't want to call darkness light. Now, every one of us has said, oh, I don't want to call darkness light. And then we walk around and we say, oh, the Lord moved on me and I felt the Lord's presence. That's moving in the sense realm. The sense realm is darkness. And that's calling darkness light. Or could be. Okay. We need to know the Lord, have the Lord, when nails are being driven into our hands and spears in our side, we can say, Father, forgive them. You know, that's kind of being tuned in. But somebody just kind of gives us a cross look and we get upset and we go into a dither for a week. You know, my God, did you hear? Well, I just feel. We dwell in darkness. We draw all that we get from it because that's the way we were before we got saved, and now we've approached the Bible, which is not the Word, if you understand. You have to go to the Father to get the Word. The total thought. What is His total thought and concept? And I mean, it was powerful when the Holy Spirit taught me that this was His total thought. I mean, I was all ready to be the greatest evangelist in the world. I was afraid to be, but, you know, I mean, I was going to do this for God, for God. I'm going to do this for God, man, you know, and I was going to be a humdinger for Jesus, you know, and when I saw that there ain't but one humdinger for Jesus, and that's Jesus, then he put me in him, I said, okay, I can take my place. I can handle that. You know, I remember for a while there going through gyrations, and what about me? God, don't do about me. You know, I went through some stuff like that, and then I kept seeing this, and I went, I don't even care what the stupid thoughts I'm thinking, because they are stupid thoughts in light of this. His ways are so far above our ways. You know, and you'll be happier being hid in Christ. I can totally tell you that will, if you're in the right place when you have come to the realization, and you will. You will. And you will be content. Paul says stuff like, in whatsoever state you find yourself there, and be content. That's a spirit realm state. He's got to be coming from here, because he can't be talking about, well, just be a happy person no matter what. Is that what he's saying? You try that. But if you realize that you are in the most secure place in the universe, it's a lot easier, you know. And the devil will try to shake you. And your friends will try to shake you. Your enemies will try to shake you. But all of that is working together to stabilize you. And at first, maybe he shakes you. But the shaking is only good to show you that you're not stable. So that you run back and say, okay, I really do need to give this to you. He says, I really will give it to you. If you continue my word, you shall know. And it will make you.
Something that I've learned, or am learning, is that I've always wanted to try and make myself stable. Somehow thought that I'm supposed to make me stable, but I began to realize that I never will be the stable one.
Right.
That he is the stable one. It takes the pressure out of the situation. There has to be in me. I don't have to be stable. I have to be the one who is stable.
Right.
That takes the pressure off me. Because I thought, well, it's not me. I'm not stable. My emotions aren't stable. My thoughts aren't stable. Well, of course, they're not stable. They're not, you aren't supposed to be the one that's full of stability.
Right. Sure. Part of this reason for light, we get a definition, now we're going to talk about the reason. Part of the reason for light is because we will misinterpret or misplace truths. God is very ordered. He really is. He's a God of order. If you just look at the universe, it's this huge clock that just moves perfectly. You know, it's just huge, you know, I mean, it's pretty orderly. Set our lives right. And we get things out of order. So we come without light, and we view life, or we experience life, and so we want more life. But light from God about life will do one thing. It will not first reveal life to you. Light about life will not first reveal life to you. It will reveal that in him, the word is life, not in you. Now, that's a big revelation. Because before that time, you didn't really understand the complete thought concept of God. You thought maybe you understood life, but you felt like there's a good understanding of life. I got life. I don't know what else. I got life. I may not know much, but I got life. You know what I mean? I mean, these are the things we say. But the truth is, the life is in him, in the word. It's not just in him who is life. Life is in him who is life. No. Here's where the breakdown comes. Life emanates from a realization of the Father's viewpoint about this one called his son, the Word. Life can only grow out of the complete thought and concept of God. Because if it grows in us, it's not the complete thought and concept of God. It's us growing in God. Okay, so you want an increase. It's funny. The way to get an increase of life is to decrease. Isn't that funny? So almost sounds like the senior class scriptures. Wow. And now just where they graduate, they're hearing the truth. You know? There's only one way. Now that's not the normal human way. The normal human way, humans, I don't necessarily mean bad humans, I just mean humans, is that the way you gain is to give. Now that's the human concepts that we live by. But God's way is not that way. You gain by losing. You get by giving. It's totally contrary to what we call the world system. It's built on those other principles. God's system is built by totally giving. God gave you the best thing he could ever give. He didn't give you junk. He gave his the total bond concept. He gave everything. He gave his son. But look what he gives now. His son over and over and over again through many sons. Because he sowed, he also reaped. But because we don't want to sow, because we don't think of it as sowing, we think of it as losing. So we are frightened sometimes when we hear teaching like this because, oh, don't deter me. I want to seek life. I want life. But you see, how can you have life in you and how can it increase without abiding as a branch in your life? Long before you were, there was this life substance, if you would, I want to put it this way. This fine substance on the inside that was life long before anybody. All that we have done is plugged into it. Okay, now we've done more than just say, I'm abiding in Jesus because I'm continuing as a believer. I'm continuing as a believer, and I do that every day, so I'm abiding in Christ, so he's abiding in me. That's not what he's talking about. The vine, if you're a branch, and you're not connected, the vine is everything. It's not just a good idea. This is not something to kind of be believed in. It is everything, and you better be more than just kind of believe in the general direction of the vine. That if there's a vine somewhere, or there's a vine over there. You better believe into the vine. You better understand the logos, the complete thought and concept of God. This is it, the total, the I am that I am, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega. He that was and is and is to come. You see, John, that wrote this good old boy that he was and loved Jesus as he did, he walked with Jesus 3.5 years. But when he's in the Isle of Patmos, having been banished for Jesus, he's sitting there, banished away, and all of a sudden, he's caught up into heaven, and he's sitting there, and he's talking to angels and stuff, and all of a sudden, he turns around, and he sees the Lord. What is it? First, second, third chapter, right along there somewhere. First chapter, I think it is. And he sees the Lord, and he falls on his face as though dead. Well, you know, I want to, you know, I'm always in the picture somewhere. I want to walk over, can't say, get up, you walk with him 3.5 years. What's your problem, Jack? It's just Jesus. You know, now, come on, man. You know this guy. But he saw him. And let me just read that for you. I think it's a chapter. Great. Save me a little rubbish. A good one, brother. Okay, now listen to this. This is the guy that walked with him, thought he knew it. Listen to this. And when I saw H.I.M., he didn't see a truth, he saw him. I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not, I am. He didn't say, fear not, you're going to be okay. It's okay, itty bitty. Life's been tough, but hey. He said, fear not. I am the first, the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys to hell and of death. Sounds pretty good to me. Sounds like he is everything. And I think that's what he saw, is that there was personal strength until he saw the Lord. And then he went, oh, he just boom, bam. But Jesus said to him, don't worry, I am. Well, you know, can you imagine laying down there in a heap as though dead going, well, great, what about me? You know, I kind of need a little help here. I'm a mess. Like, really, you know, give me some stuff. Jesus didn't do that. He's not going to do it for you. Well, yes. That is whatever. But eventually what he wants to do is have you see him the way he is, fall in a heap as though dead, so that he can say, you're not.
I am.
And you're in. And you go, that life, that flow. Now you got life, but you weren't seeking life in you. You were seeking the total thought and concept of God. I am this. I am he that was and is. I am. And when you believe into that, all that the I am is in you. Awesome. You just, all you're doing is abiding.
It seems like most people when they become believers, they switch mentality, so to speak. I mean, it's the same thought, it seems like it's a thought process, a switch. Because a lot of people tend to believe themselves not to be self-centered anymore because it's like, I was looking.
They don't do selfish things.
Well, the thing is,
mean, cruel.
I was looking through them. I was curious as to not what are the people, you know, what are people looking for? So I was looking. We have these single path things that work with reading them and stuff, and they're kind of humorous sometimes. And I came across a couple of Christians once. There was supposed to be Christians, Christian whatever. And I noticed that the difference is with non-Christians, everything's focused on their attributes. You know, I'm this. I'm that. I'm tall. I'm good. Other. Whereas the ones with them, the ones with Christians, they're not thinking themselves not self-centered because they don't focus on those things, but rather now they're looking at things on the outside of them to fulfill their needs. And the three things I noticed that all the ads said, it's so weird. They all wanted somebody who was like emotionally and financially stable, and then it was all with some love the Lord.
And that's, you know, cool. That work out.
Right.
But here's not the Lord.
Yeah. But the thing is that what's actually happened is people, at least believers,
they want to get what they want.
They're probably going to. That's why I don't want to see them. The thing that I've seen this happen is by their own thoughts, they determine steps of what that is.
Right.
And then by their actions, that confirms that everything's true.
Right.
You know, it's like they decide in their thoughts what is the Lord for their life. And because it is whatever it is, or some action that happens, that confirms it. Rather than trusting God. Like you said, most people don't want to hear this because it would shake the foundation because they don't want to be told that you live in the Lord's Christ that is game. They don't hear something like that.
Right. Yeah, that's why all those scriptures say what they say. Yeah. Blessed and merciful, they should obtain mercy. To live is to die for yourself. Come follow me, take up your cross. All those scriptures that bring that out. But really and truly, all they are doing is pulling you back here to this, the one in whom you are, who is. What is he? See, I don't know. I'm not sure what we're trying to get a hold of when we say we're in Christ. But I'll tell you what we need to get a hold of, and that is light. And that would be, I can't give you, I can fellowship in the light that you have, but I can't give it to you, but I can declare the light. But what we're after is to understand that it is God the Father who has declared that His Son is His complete thought and concept, and that anything we do or accomplish apart from, outside of, or without the life force that is this one is absolutely useless. Now, I mean, when I saw that, I felt his fingers over there. Because I, it took all this stuff out of me that, you know, first of all, I would see from time to time, maybe you can identify it. Before that time, I would see from time to time strength in me that wasn't the Lord. I would find attitudes in me, not necessarily bad attitudes, but sometimes prideful attitudes or ambitions, things like that. And sometimes I would see those, like maybe I would be, I would see those and think that they were okay or something, and then be in a service and the preacher preaches just in such a way that it's like light shined on that, and I saw that was bad or not the Lord. And at that moment, I saw how big it was, and I thought, how am I ever going to get rid of this, or at least within the next 20 years? Anybody, I remember kind of going, oh, God, this is bad, you know? I mean, I don't know. I remember thinking, this is so intertwined with who I am that I don't know how this can ever be really, really rooted up. That was kind of the way I looked at it. How can this ever really, really be rooted up from? And so those things would come every once in a while, and they would come by the Lord's deal. So you knew that it was a right feeling. You know, you're just going, oh, God, you know, so you just, you know, you never fully forget those times of light shines like that. You just go, oh, so deep down, you're kind of going, oh, God, you know. But I remember when the Lord began to shine light, and I began to see the way the Father viewed the Logos, that it was His total thought concept, that anything that was not the Son was not of God. That anything that was not the Son, because how could it be of God? You say, of God. See, we use that term a whole different way. And I began to really, really, because it was truly light, see, well, if this is true, then most of what I've done for the Lord is like, should be counted dumb. I wasn't seeing this like I was really bummed out, you know, in this blues all day. This was like, you know, I saw it from the Lord. It's all, not just that which is bad, but that which is gain, is done. And only that which the Father declares to be valid, if you will, in the fullest sense, is valid. Okay. That did more. It didn't have to root anything out in that sense. It rooted me out. It's like me, I'm a black card face, the front and back, and a deck, and I keep coming up. You know, so I keep coming up, not every time, but there it is again, it's in there. You know, pick a color, that black one, you know. I'm there, I'm always there. You know, but it's like all of a sudden the Lord shows up in the deck and takes that black and throws out. I'm not even a factor anymore. But He didn't just throw me out. Yes, He threw that which was not His Son out, but He made me one with. He crucified the old and made me one with, and the one I'm one with is this one. And that has become the identity, so that those other factors if you truly see life the way I'm talking about, then, and you don't just see it once, but I mean, as you see this, the more you see it, the more you begin to comprehend it, then you go, you start to do something. And you go, this is just a good idea for me. Lord, what do you want? Okay, now that's easy when you're just a person. When you become a leader, it's harder. Because people start going, hey, we've got to do something here. Well, I ain't going to do nothing unless it's the Lord. You can't just not do nothing. People are leaving. Or whatever. I mean, I know the pressures. And you just go, we're not doing nothing unless it's the Lord. We're not doing anything. We're not doing anything unless it's the Lord. And so, if they leave, good. They're if I did something and it wasn't the Lord and that kept them, then that's not the Lord. And I want more of what's not the Lord, so I think I'll let them leave. I will only, and so then all of a sudden the Lord gives you something and you move and everybody knows it's the Lord. You know what I mean? They go, man, that was the Lord. And then they're all for it. They're about to crucify you when they didn't see anything. But do you know what I'm going to tell you? For you, it is just as noble to not move when you know it's something's not the Lord as to move when you know it is the Lord. But we don't tend to do that. We tend to move when it's the Lord, when we know it's the Lord, and to move when it's not the Lord so that we keep up appearances or something. I don't know. I just know that we don't want to not be liked, or we don't want the pressure, or we don't want people thinking stuff, or, you know, I mean, you know, Jesus was a man of brought his sorrows and acquainted with grief. I am one with him. I mean, everybody, he never did a thing wrong, not just a thing wrong, he never had an attitude wrong, he never said a word that was out of a wrong spirit. Everything was perfect about him, and he was accused of having demons at one point. And I'm hurt because somebody thought something bad about me. You know, can you see the Father wanting to turn his eyes from the Word? Oh, you poor little thing, come on, keep going. I mean, he said, look, if you're following me and you're being persecuted for that, you ought to rejoice. You know what I mean? You ought to be rejoicing. Instead, you're whining.
Could might possibly represent or be the Holy Spirit that shines light on the Word, which is the total thought concept of God, to reveal the life, which is not the life that we think, but the life, which is the Son, His Son. Could the life possibly be the Holy Spirit, or represent?
Well, the Holy Spirit is the avenue of the life, because it says that He is the life. He is that life. It says here, the Son came for a witness to bear witness of the life that all men through Him. He was not that life, but was sent to bear witness of that life. And it's got a good capital. The Lord is the life, the Word. Because, and wouldn't it make sense if He is the total thought concept that He would be the life, peace, joy, love, you know what I mean? I mean, you see, it doesn't get hard to, you know, after a while it gets easy to figure everything out. It always goes right back here. Really? But the Holy Spirit, you know, there ain't going to be no lies about the avenue of the Holy Spirit. So that's why you were saying that, is because you know that this can't come without the Word of the Holy Spirit. You're absolutely right.
I've been wondering sometimes people think about the order of words in John, about light coming before light, and because it seems like there should be first life and then light in us. I mean, for us, it should be first life and then light. That's what I was thinking. That one. Well, shouldn't it be first life and then light? But for God, it is. The Lord said, no, you have to have light before you see what already is. Before you see what already is. And I just went, oh, because the light's not in me. And I need the light to see what already is before I can start abiding. You know, for God, it's first light. See His light, and then He sheds the light, lets there be light. But for us, it's first light, to see the light that already is. then we can start having life, but not...
That used to confuse me, though, because I would hear that. I would, somebody, like, you'd hear that, and I'd say, well, life is not in me, it's, oh, it's in him. And then somebody would smile, feel real good about that, and I'd go, well, what does that mean? You're just making it hard. You know, I mean, that's the way I felt. Because I was going, you know, you can't lay hold of this unless the Lord can show you. But I was just going, you know, okay, wasn't it? But what it means is that that he is all that God is after. And it is something totally separate from you. Unless you identify it. We think it's something that if we understand something about it, like, I'm not sure what, that it's going to, like, release. It's like a valve that's going to release that lie. Okay. But still, somehow, we're concentrating more on us. This is where we get the concept of the vine. So here's the vine. Big old vine. We're big in the content of the thing here. But in reality, we're in here, and notice I didn't draw it, because we're hid in him. But when he appears, we're like him, and that's all that's important. Okay, when am I going to be like him? When he appears. Well, has he appeared to the Father?
Yeah.
Am I like him to the Father? Yes. Has he fully appeared in me? No, he hasn't fully appeared in me. But does that change the fact that I'm hid in him?
No.
That's something I always thought somehow, just a self-centered viewpoint, is that the proof of me having life or knowing the life was when I saw it manifest through me. That's
right.
Not true.
Yeah.
Because you have the life when you see that the life is in him.
Right.
And that the life is only in him. And that I have that life just by virtue of being in Christ.
Right.
Christ is my life. Now this place is just a place for it to manifest.
Right.
Just as it doesn't manifest, it's anything you don't have.
Absolutely.
And that's where we get so, I've gotten so often, so shaken, in and out, up and down, and, you know, whatever, because I was just waiting for this life to shoot through this branch, you know, okay. And just, I didn't start at the beginning, you know, where the life is in the Word, there. And only the, I don't understand what that means, totally, but you don't have to in order to abide in the Word. That's the good thing, so I thought understanding was the avenue by which I, come forth, but manifestation is only a place because the place where it manifests is a created place. The place where life was is an eternal place that created, and things which are seen are not made by things which do appear. So, I mean, yes, this, you know, so that's where you go when life is.
The see, the word of God, you know, the scripture that emanated from this word is forming your way of thinking.
Exactly.
Even the way you speak the word has your mind runs, and it runs right into a scripture that is based, not just a scripture, but a scripture that's based on the Word.
Right.
Because the scripture, the Pharisees made the scripture.
Right.
But a scripture based on the Word, and your mind, and your, which directed your words, went back, or went on down, and kept moving down this avenue. It's like, and I know what it means to have a renewed mind. I know what it means, I can discern when somebody's beginning to have one, because thoughts run and they hit a scripture that keeps them funneled in the truth, but it's not really funneled because the truth is all everywhere. But nonetheless, certain scriptures at first captivate your thoughts and pull you down and become captive to the Word of God.
Right. But the manifestation, is, you know, we also think manifestation is so much more stable, but really this is a creative place so that what's really true can just be seen in another way.
Right.
You see it, eyes on both. See it here was the proof that you had it, but it's not. Your proof, your faith is your proof that you have it. And then it kind of will reflect down here, you know. But that's just a place for it to kind of show up. But it's not the real place. You know, that's where I got mixed up.
Well, a lot of times our faith is, we think, we put us here, and our faith is some sort of channel that causes it. Like this.
Yeah.
Okay. That's not the way it works. That is a very bad way it works. In reality, we're in here, and by faith, we're in there.
That's
right. Amen. But the faith is not, has anything to do with the life other than that the life will eventually manifest. Your faith is just that you're in Christ. Not, my faith is that I'm in Christ so that. No, You are in Christ. And by the way, if you're born again, you're in Christ. God, so wise, put you there from the very beginning. Okay. All you're going to do is figure it out, and the more you figure it out, the more that you are able to flow with light and life, and you'll find that it just flows. I don't know what other words to put, but the truth is, if it never flowed. Now this is something that when you see the things that I shared so far out of John up to where we came to, there was a man, or even all things were made. The things I shared about those first couple of verses, about him being the same and the word and everything, God showed me that. I mean, I know that God showed me that. God the Father showed me that. And I saw, before there was anything that came out from this union, creation, a man sent from God. See, I know where we're going. I know that then the word's going to manifest and it's going to gather people. A lot of big stuff's going to happen. But it ain't big stuff. This is the biggest as it gets. All of that is just what I call automatics. And if it just happens, this brings about this. And I'll show you. I mean, I've already showed you. But this is based on those first couple of scriptures. I'll show you how everything, including this ministry, God showed it to me before he started the creation. Showed me how it would work, flow, and eventually produce. And there is a progression. But none of that's important. This is all that was important. So before all that, God showed me this union, and not just between the Father and the Son. But I understand the Son to be the Logos, the total form concept of God, that this is the fullness of what he's after. Okay, so if you really see that, then once you create something, you just set them down in this, but you just, how can you, what do you do? Turn from this and go, oh, well, that created this, and oh, cool. You know, I mean, light of this, there's just nothing like it. There's nothing, because it just separates you from the darkness. Sense realm, no, it just separates. The light divides the darkness. And you just go, oh, you know. And then, see, everything is not a challenge. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's like, I don't know. How do I deal with that? What'd they say? Well, what's, you know, oh, I feel an itch. Should I scratch it? I mean, I don't even know. See, it's been so long since I've, but I remember kind of walking around going, I mean, it's like the will of God was in every piece of anything, and I had to figure it out. You know what I mean? That scared me, because I knew I was going to miss a bunch, you know? And I was just like, I was paranoid for God, you know? And I really loved the Lord, so I didn't want to mess up. Then I realized that none of this was the will of God. This is the will of God. In everything, give thanks. In everything. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. See? Did I make these scriptures all of a sudden say this? Or say, have they always said this? The total thought, it always points here, because this is God's total thought. This is the Word. When you read the Word, it's going to point here, and if it doesn't, be careful. And I used to think, well, there's a big book there. I have a lot of stuff. But even when he's talking about, you know, practical things, you know, this and that and that, and then, you know, it's a great mystery, but, you know, it's this union, this oneness, he talks about this stuff, and he always, you know, the life that if there's a problem, he puts life into it. What we try to do is just figure it out, and okay, it's like everything is based on some decision that God has. You know, God, you know, which piece of chalk would God really want me to use today? I could care less, you know? No?
That's like pulling life down to the central reality you're trying to. And you think that's, we think that's life, that's what we do that. That is life, that's not life.
No. So anyway, that was a man. God. That meant that this life is the light of men. The light in him was life, the life is the light of men, and there was glory to God. Glory to God. Does that give anybody hope? You know, it's not all just over here in the beginning before us. There is no way, no way, it's too deep. Randy, I don't even understand all that you shared in class. Well, you know, if you did, you probably wouldn't be here. And if you think that sitting in class is going to teach this to you, and if you do understand everything and go out of here feeling real good about yourself, you're probably worse off than the one saying, I don't understand. Because if you think you can come here and sit and get the eternal, living, total thought concept of God from some skinny, gray-haired, ugly-looking old mustache dude, you don't. It ain't. You're going to get it from the Holy Spirit. But there is a man sent from God. Yeah, that right? And all I'm trying to do is declare that there is light that can lead your life that has to be found in him. It will link you to this relationship and make you aware of how strong this thing is. And you know what that does? It relieves you from the will of God. It puts the will of God in Christ. And that's where you just, if you just find rest for your soul. Seriously. It is tremendous. It's like a big, huge weight falls off of you. You just go, oh, thank God. And you just go, I'm in Christ. And you're just happy. You know, before you go, well, I don't want to just be in Christ. I want to stick my leg out so somebody can see I got a leg. Or something. You know what I mean? I don't know. You know. But when you get to that point, man, it just all falls off. You just go, man, I'm so glad to be in your son. I'm glad he's your total thought concept. And I'm glad this plan is dependent on you because it is your plan. It is of you, by you, for you, through you, to you. And so you begin to rest. Eventually, in you, the vessel, that treasure begins to come out. But I'm just going to say again, that is not... This is primary. Anything that happens in you is only, it's only a manifestation of truth, manifestation of lack of truth, or hypocrisy. You know, the Greek word for hypocrisy comes from the Greek word used in drama. It's put on a mask. To act a part that you know. That's what we call religion. Religion. I think like Jesus. We can go to Jesus masks. But then we go, and then we almost convince ourselves as we look in the mirror and say, oh, Jesus mask. And then we act like Adams. You know what I'm saying? And we go, whoa, conscious. Ain't manifested yet. No, you're manifested. No question who's manifested. You're manifested. And it ain't your little Jesus mask. Because that mask is not life. And that mask isn't in him. If it was, it would be life. The mask is on you. As long as it's on you, not emanating from him. That's the handle.
I was just thinking about Psalm 119 where it was. Just to me, just when I was reading it, it seems like this guy is just really manifesting a lot of things that aren't God. But he keeps making the confession of, I'll hold for your word, I'll never forget your word, that, you know, you're going to quicken me according to your word. And I just thinking, you know, that whoever wrote that song, probably David, said, whoa, it's all the word, and God put me in the word. I'm not settled to go, but I'm in the word no matter what I manifest. Which is really cool because then he's like, even when it manifests, his position isn't going to change. You know, he's not going to go, now it's manifesting, I don't need the word anymore. But the whole time, the word was everything to him. And it's just cool. It's just been a real cool song to me in that sense, just to see how this person abode in the word and confess only the word, no matter what kind of stuff is coming out.
Mm-hmm. God, just...
Well, I don't anymore, but I'm not sure.
Okay, I guess we're good. Laura, Father, thank you for this time. I just ask you to thank the sun stand still so I can teach over. Father, we just have to go. It's your son. Your Holy Spirit is the one who teaches us, and we're going to trust him. We're going to trust him.